No, no, I just want to be sure because I was throwing white things that were not.
Upscale.
Okay, so couple things. We've been talking up to now about the built or the natural landscape of Los Angeles, the body of the city, as it were. And now we're going to turn to the aesthetic landscape, which is more the consciousness or soul, if we want to follow that metaphor. As a writer, I'm always looking for a master metaphor to hang everything on. It'll make structural sense. But of course, if Los Angeles has anything to tell us, it's that such binaries are too reductive. Soul or consciousness is a function of body, after all. In that sense, it couldn't be more appropriate that we're about to hear from Ron Athey, whose art has been rooted in the body. He's an LA original, a performance artist, an activist. You can read his bio in the program, but for more than 30 years, he has made art and performance here that provokes our sensibilities as a way of opening up our hearts. His subject matter is body, blood, illness, the frailty and resilience of the human, the engagement and the discomfort of the audience. He could have made this work anywhere, but it seems to me it's particularly relevant against the landscape of Los Angeles, which is often sanitized on its surfaces. Hollywood, the Dream Factory, the industrial entertainment complex, and a setting against which the underground must continually assert itself. Interviewing him is Carolina Miranda, who, among other things, is one of the, you know, two or three most essential voices at the Los Angeles Times. We should all be grateful to her for being part of our daily journalistic project. Carolina and Ron have been having a kind of ongoing conversation about art, expression, and the underground, and there was a Q&A in the Los Angeles Times in September, right? You guys spoke on the day of the eclipse. Among other things, I commend them for getting the word asshole into print in the Los Angeles Times. That's always a, getting the Times to use contemporary language is always a challenge. Anyway, we're delighted that they will continue the conversation here for us. So please welcome Carolina Miranda and Ron Athey.
Thank you. Right. Hello.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for that wonderful intro, and thank you for being here. I know we're the last group of the day, so we will try to keep it entertaining. So starting with that, this was a video of a band called Nervous Gender, their song Miscarriage, shot at the Target, which was some dank warehouse in San Francisco?
In San Francisco, yeah.
So tell me a little bit, who was Nervous Gender? Why are they significant? Why should we be watching this video?
Nervous Gender was started by two queer men.
One from Dublin, one from Mexico City, who both went to schools called Cardinal Newman.
So, in their respective cities.
Yes.
Wow.
So they started a, you know, what's being called electropunk or synth punk band in 77, 78, which has had rotating members. Michael Ochoa is also a member of that collective.
And what was significant? Because I think, you know, we see punk videos today in this age of all kinds of video and insanity going on YouTube, and stuff like this can seem a little quaint. What made Nervous Gender so edgy, so different when they first came on the scene?
I think queer hadn't been defined yet then, so this is the height of the gay clone. Everybody looked like the Marlboro Man in West Hollywood. So then you have Nervous Gender, who are taking leather culture looks, punk looks. They also had an underage drummer who was in a relationship with their manager, who was 40. That's just the, you know, pre-Mies Commission realities. So they were against the edge, and I don't know, it was extreme. It was very political, I guess.
What was the concept? Like, did you ever see them perform? Were they a band that you ran into?
Often. They played a lot at the Brave Dog, which was in the same building as the Atomic Cafe. So that's where I felt like that was their home space, where they would just play in jock straps. And to see that in, like, 1979 was like, wow, they're fags, and they're just, you know, blatant. That seemed like a really big deal at that time.
What was the context of LA generally? Like, what do you think gave rise to something like Nervous Gender, and who did they appeal to?
I think there's these lines in 70s punk, where punk was really arty, and there was a performance art. There was also mutated classical acts like Fat and Fucked Up that played cello, violin. So punk isn't exactly the most accurate term, but it was the scene at that time. People from the suburbs, like me, were blamed on ruining it. The Orange County hardcore scene, Black Flag, suddenly it became very macho, very speedy. All the music had to be super hard. The germs went in that direction. So Nervous Gender kind of preceded that. I think they were influenced by the Screamers, which was one of the first bands with Tomato de Pliny. And so the music, it wasn't the crudest music. They were using synthesizers. They were going for a different sound.
I think, you know, one of the reasons I was really interested in talking about Nervous Gender and showing this video is that they represented this kind of cross current of undergrounds, that LA had a lot of undergrounds. There were leather undergrounds, there were queer performance punk undergrounds, there were Chicano art undergrounds, and that this band, and so many of them overlapped with each other,
exactly.
And that this band connected a lot of those different strings. So what threads of LA do you see displayed in work by bands like Nervous Gender?
Well, there was a sexual revolution, like as in an abject sexual revolution. So with members of Nervous Gender, I would go to Greg's Blue Dot for church at 6 a.m. on a Sunday morning. So for us, I was going to visit old school, where people were playing tambourines and fan dancing to Donna Summer. Like, that was over my head. But, you know, through a misty haze of drugs, like quite interesting social studies to see kind of the generation before.
And they were connecting. I mean, Gerardo, what's interesting too is Gerardo Velasquez, who's seen here playing the keyboards. Well, not that guy. He was playing the keyboards in the first part of the video. He was Chicano, lived in East LA,
yeah,
if I'm not mistaken. Made art, was connected with Chicano art scenes, was connected with music scenes, was connected with queer scenes, underground scenes. And so in one band, I think in this day and age, in 2017, where everything is so niche, what was interesting about what was happening then is that one underground scene often linked with the next, that it wasn't this kind of separation of church and state, and that there was this dynamic.
Yeah.
That went on. So, you know, I'd love to, in thinking, oh, and actually Gerardo is represented in two exhibitions right now. One, Access Mundo, organized by the One National Gay and Lesbian Archives, which is based here at USC. The exhibition's in West Hollywood. And there's a show of Gerardo's work at Coagula Curatorial in Chinatown. So if you want to see more from that era, there's definitely more to go check out there. But I wanted to go back to a larger question, because part of the reason I wanted to speak with Ron here today is because Ron is teaching a whole class on subcultures in the underground here at USC. He has a 13-page syllabus that covers everything from, here I have a few samples, from an article titled The Secret Life of a Satanist to Melvin Van Peebles' Sweet Sweet Backs Badass Song, and Joey Terrell's Homeboy Beautiful, which was a Chicano queer zine.
Yeah, way ahead of its time.
Yeah, and so part of the reason I was interested in speaking to Ron is he's teaching all of these underground. So I want to get a sense of, like, why was L.A. in the 70s and 80s such fertile ground for these, like, little scenes that congregated in warehouses and storefronts and...
The first answer is almost sad, because looking at different countercultures such as the Cockettes, it really comes down to affordability. There were a lot of storefronts that weren't even like $200 a month to rent, that became rehearsal studios, pop-up galleries, and a gallery then would be somewhere where an experimental art band would play. So all of these things were possible without high, you know, people didn't have to work two jobs to pay the rent. You could make a venue. You didn't have to wait to be programmed. You made your own scene. So this is the DIY aesthetic formed itself because of that. I think also LA specifically always knows, especially in that time, that it's in the shadow of Hollywood, or it's in the shadow of a really commercial music industry. So there's something to rub against.
So that it's almost a little bit of an inspiration or something to react against.
I mean, that was a purist era, like kill your television set, who's Lonnie Anderson, to actually like narrow down to what you found important and pretend that, you know, I ignored Madonna for about 10 years, that it didn't happen. Same thing with Lady Gaga.
Why did you ignore Madonna?
I guess my real beef is against art directors and stylists. They go through everything, like scanning to give somebody a look for one video who's meaningless. Whoops.
I mean, I guess that gets at the idea of the larger idea of like what is an underground and what binds these communities. What is to you an underground? Like, let's define our terms. If Madonna is not it, obviously.
Well, it's counterculture, and then something else. It can be something oppressed for various reasons, including being illegal. So then when you lift all of those away, it's not underground anymore. And I think why I tried to devise a class around looking at underground movements from religion to art was to try to understand the time we're in more, which since the 90s I've been confused about the kind of cut and paste swirl we're in. Like, is there ever going to be another like real movement again? The last one I was involved in was, you know, the kind of Wax Trax era, club fuck techno dance, that where body modification and electronic music sort of merged together and exhibitionism.
And you're feeling that now that those kinds of organic movements aren't really happening, that...
Or they happen as a gesture. They don't happen with the same depth. Like, I see them referred to, but, you know, I'm not saying they never will again. We've just been in a catching up phase. Maybe it's population growth. Maybe it's, I don't know. I think in the 80s I thought if everybody was cool, it'd be a perfect world. And now I realize it'd just be a world without meaning.
I think that I want to get at your story as part of this, because you were part of a lot of these undergrounds. Ron was, you grew up, you're a very nice boy who grew up in a Pentecostal family in Pomona.
Well, that's really the lowdown, is I see everything through a churchy lens. You know, I was raised to be a minister, so when I left that and was left with a God hole, I would dive into things, like, full on.
Oh, instead of, in lieu of church, like,
yeah,
seeking.
Yeah, we're with the same. It's the only way I knew how to immerse myself in something. So
that same zeal.
Yeah.
That you had to. So you first emerged, I mean, people ought to track your bio to your early emergence to a band called Christian Death, speaking of the Pentecostal. Tell us a little bit about Christian Death. What were you doing with them? What did they do? Where did they play? Did they get naked? Like.
When I was 16 and 17, I worked summers at the Jonas Salk Institute. I was kind of going in a science direction, and where they would take us back to Pomona was at the Claremont Colleges. And so somebody there said, oh, I want you to meet my friend Roz. He has this band, Christian Death, and they're rehearsing in this garage. So I literally went to a garage where a band was rehearsing and started a relationship with them eventually.
And that is.
And they hadn't played yet then, so it was like 1980.
Oh, and they were just rehearsing. They were just, were they Christian Death yet? They
yeah.
were. And then, so what was your involvement with Christian Death, and what appealed to you about them? What made you think you needed to leave the Jonas Salk Institute and hang out with Christian Death?
Oh, I was already leaving the Jonas Salk Institute by the time I was there. It was a real proper scene, you know, and it was also, I was already into punk, but. You know, after getting a few bruises, slam dancing, I was already ready for something more sophisticated. And suddenly this kind of, it's what the writer Brendan Mullen called the Gothic Crucible of the Inland Empire. It just exploded there.
And what was the music like? Could you give us a little bit of a sense?
It's based in a type of intricate rock and roll. And eventually they had the guitar player from the Adolescents, which was a Orange County hardcore band. So. It was a bit more of a refined sound than you know, four chord bands going on at the time.
And what did you do with them?
First, I was kind of the Pamela DeBars with the band. And then I started working on staging the shows with Ross. So the kind of most notorious show at the Whiskey A Go-Go in 1982. I crucified Ross on a cross in stockings and high heels and cut his palms open. And the crowd erupted into kind of a riot.
What happened? Was the band pulled?
It just got rowdy. Everyone started pushing everything, stampeding out, and cursing. So it was kind of mixed response, but at a high pitch. And this is always my argument for performance art that comes out of somewhere else besides the academy. The academy around other people that'll let you be boring, give you feedback. There's a genre that's referring to itself, but to take it into the club, such as, you know, people who inspired me, like Johanna Wendt.
What did Johanna Wendt do?
She would play with, like, Black Flag, but, you know, she used animal entrails, masks, mostly dumpster diving materials.
Mm-hmm. And she would use them on stage.
She would use them on stage, but the point is the intensity that she performed at for a punk crowd was different than if you were in, like, a white cube gallery.
So this is this era in which you literally get connected to culture one person at a time. One person connects the next. And
right,
that
and
spaces
at that age where
really
it's like this magic door that opens, like, the, you know, Nervous Gender Boys took me to see a Pasolini double bill, a Salo, and Teorama. I wasn't politically as sophisticated to understand that, like, fascist pull in Italy, but just, you know, Pasolini's lushness turned me out forever.
So it was these, like, sort of mind.
The New Beverly.
At the New Beverly, which is now, that's
the
now
New
Quentin
Beverly
Tarantino-centric
yeah. center.
Now, then you went on to form a band with Roz as well.
That was a performance project with noise musicians called Premature Ejaculation, or PE. That was 1981. And the tabloids of that time were so important to the scene. No Magazine, Slash Magazine, research publications before it became a book.
Mm-hmm. These were all like rock and culture.
Yeah, the idea would be it'd be about the music scene, but then it would go, you know, it would review artists like Gina Pone. It would it would bring you into different ethnographies. I don't know. It opened up. I think it's what linked body modification to a music scene. There would always be pages about rock and roll tattoos.
And so how did premature ejaculation figure into this? Like, what kind of stuff did you guys do? Where did you play?
There was a space on the Pomona Mall, which I think was built in the 60s to look like an old mall, was always a disaster, so it was immediately empty. So there was one of the storefronts, this guy named Art started Art's Building. And then later he had one in Eagle Rock called Art's Building Junior. So Art wanted us to do a performance there. So we did these explosive noise, splatter. I was already crawling through broken glass. Some people compare it to G.G. Allen, but it wasn't.
It was around the same time as G.G. Allen, no?
It was.
When we started Notorious.
It was. I think
rocker.
There's something that leaves a resonance. High Performance Magazine was also important, which documented Hermann Nietzsche performed in L.A. in like 81.
And one of the Viennese actionists.
Yeah, and then
work with like animal
Susan
entrails.
Martin produced that and had like an 80-member punk orchestra and an inch of animal blood in the gallery. 77 Comb Transmissions. You know, which was Genesis P. Orich and Cozy Fanny Tootie performed here. So those, what was left behind of those performances, like, I really wanted to know how you could express yourself through that way, beyond words, beyond noise.
How do you think, okay, so you have all of these undergrounds that are bubbling around Los Angeles, and you also refer to them as the avant-garde in your class syllabus. Like, what effects have you seen them have on the... You say that you're studying these undergrounds so that you can understand today. So what effects did subcultures such as this have on the culture that we sort of take for granted as mainstream culture today?
I think initially it was really precious in a kind of closed circuit, which has its own kind of intensity and specialness. But look at Christian Death, like, goth never ends. There's gothletics, health goth, there's fetish goths, you know, then the old-fashioned neo-Victorian goths, you know, for instance. Like, yeah. I feel like nothing ever ends now. Everything that ever was is always with us.
And then there's now a whole cycle of backyard punk parties around Los Angeles. Like,
that's
that.
Good. Maybe that's where the new underground is.
In
I
backyards.
Think when we look backwards, sometimes you forget how many people were at things. Like, especially with performance art, there'll be like 8 people in the room at a Stellark performance. And, you know, in the photos, you think, oh, these. It's because they were documented. They take on a different context in time.
So, also in the 80s, what's happening around the country and in Los Angeles is the AIDS crisis. And how do you think that shaped what you saw? Because you were talking about in the 70s, sort of the idea of, you know, a band that is queer and playing with gender, like that was kind of a dangerous idea. So we fast forward to the 80s, AIDS is now an issue. How does it affect what's happening culturally in Los Angeles and perhaps shape other subcultures in the process?
Well, I think when the AIDS crisis started reaching a certain pitch, it forced really close-knit communities to start to caretake, you know, even beyond the political protests that had to happen. That's kind of an unmatched intensity to anything I've ever been around, both going through that many deaths, but also the drama around death.
And the politics of death.
The politics of death, and also the reactionary moral police started coming in, even from inside, trying to like stop sex.
Yeah. Oh,
which
you mean
didn't
like
happen in LA, but it happened.
The safe sex.
Safe sex, but all the bathhouses were closed in San Francisco and New York and not in LA.
Bathhouses.
But there was became a sex negative sort of approach. So, of course, needing something to rub against, it became a way of defining maybe a different sexuality or a more intense sexuality as the persona, and not just as a color.
Yeah, something you said something with like no manners. I think earlier when we were talking about it, which raises an interesting zine that you teach in your class called Infected Faggot Perspectives.
Coming up this week,
and there are samples of it in the one archive, which resides here at USC, so you can see it. Tell me a little bit about what that was, in terms of what it represented.
I think the intensity of living in a queer community and an artist community, also in an IV drug using a recovery community. The amount of people infected with HIV and dying of HIV, and I tested positive in 1986. It's been a long journey, but when infected faggot perspectives and diseased pariah news were visible, it was basically like, everyone's gonna die, fuck you. It was a way of, there just weren't any rules anymore of being polite. There was no one to impress. There was no one that was gonna do anything for you, because it was all over the top already. And also, just this kind of almost dark humor sometimes was necessary. AIDS jokes started up at that time from the inside, calling it Mrs. AIDS or the Mrs.
The Mrs.
Yeah.
The Mrs. And I think you mentioned...
Or AIDS-y.
AIDS-y, you said that they would have articles about tips on taking a vacation to paradise before dying. Like, there were these... kind of very acerbic.
Suppressed immune system, yeah.
These very acerbic biting, which to some degree, this kind of acerbic biting, snarky humor, I mean, it describes all of Twitter today. Like, yeah. This is kind of the humor we live by in some ways, yet here was the zine in the 1980s.
But we also expressed a lot of sappiness at the same time, too. A lot of love, saying goodbye, really... trying to live for the day, even though everything was so fucked up. And that overlapping with Queer Nation, which, everything was becoming more aggressive and even individualistic.
How do you think that changed, say, the politics of the gay movement? How did something like as small as a zine called Infected Faggot Perspectives, how could that ultimately shape, say, the culture of our city? How do you see that sort of seeping out into the culture?
I think it desensitized people so they could deal with the truth in a way, just to be blatant. But how, on the other side of that, the only issue became gay marriage, I don't know.
Oh, that it was the counteraction to this kind of normal adherence.
In a way, I mean, you can look at quotes from people like Dan Savage about why they... adopted a child at the end of this, or had a child that they had been in the culture of death, and now they chose life. Which there's also a, this is sort of analyzed in Lee Edelman's No Future, Queer Theory and Death Drive, as appropriating the language of the pro-life movement.
Oh, that the gay movement appropriated the language of the pro-life movement as a reaction to
the Pollyanna agenda, yes.
The Pollyanna agenda. You heard it here.
Maybe that's the opposite of underground Pollyanna movement.
but it's interesting that something as hard, that this publication with a very sort of hard and confrontational attitude would help spur this reaction. That maybe what we don't, that the culture reacts in some way to these little seeds planted by an underground.
I mean, to be fair, I think it's hard to understand when you live under a cloud of death for decades that suddenly this three therapy pill comes along and people are trying to quickly move on to a post-AIDS period. And how, where did everything go? What are we now? And even if, it changed AIDS, it still didn't end it, it's still not ended, but it's something else. So I don't think it's necessarily incorrect to say post, but it hasn't been put away yet.
Now, thinking about that era, you mentioned Club Fuck earlier. That was an 80s.
89.
Late 80s thing. Club Fuck was a night held at the Black Cat in Silver Lake, which is now still the Black Cat. It's a restaurant that serves upscale.
It was called Basco's then.
Yeah, and it serves, I went on their line, they serve upscale American gastropub fare. this place that was once the site of parties called Club Fuck.
And the Black Cat riots in the mid-60s, yeah, 67 or something.
And the Black Cat riots were?
They were the first riot against police brutality on the gay community.
In Los Angeles.
So it preceded Stonewall by 2 years, I think.
Wow. What was Club Fuck and what was its significance?
Club Fuck was run by three men, Miguel Beristain, Cliff Diller, and James Stone, all of who are dead now. And I feel like towards most of the 80s, a lot of people were just sitting at home getting tattooed and pierced, waiting for something to happen. And then this horrible AIDS thing was going on. And then all of a sudden there's this new music, this whole Wax Trax label, Detroit sound, Chicago techno. And this club with diverse go-go dancers, so it was me, it was Buck Angel, Jenny Shimizu. Everybody was kind of represented in really different ways. And it was like tight, like a barn, just packed full of people. And so you would see someone come first with like black jeans and a t-shirt. And then the next week they'd be there with a G-string and a harness. Like, okay, they got turnt.
The black cat did its job.
Yeah, so that was really pure for like 3 years. And then they moved to a location in Hollywood. And then 1 week Liza Minnelli came. That's how sick it is living in L.A. It's always a moment like that. We're like, what happened?
Were you there when Liza showed up?
No, I stopped going then. But, yeah.
Okay, because is there any documentation of Liza at Club Fug?
Maybe. She came with Greg Gorman. It was fun.
Which gets at this idea of how increasingly difficult it is in this age of the internet, in which communities can become instantly connected via the internet, like people who are interested in, you know, a particular school of goth can all connect instantly. How easy is it to maintain an underground now? What do we have undergrounds today?
I don't know. Which I think they just, it changed, you know, and I don't think this information on the internet is all a bad thing. I mean, I think about my teenage years in Pomona thinking that was the whole world. And then there was me, like, not just gay, not just queer, but like a distorted pervert that everything was intensified, leaving religion, leaving this religious family. And I just didn't have any sources. So I had a really, you know, destructive period of trying to figure that out until I found the right books.
Oh, but you think that the internet makes those connections faster?
They do.
But then is also, does the internet, and you and I have talked about this, is that the internet can also strip things of context.
Sure.
And that sometimes
it cheapens things.
Yeah, and that sometimes you have these very tight-knit communities that operate by a code of ethics. And that then somebody from the outside comes in and...
I believe in immersion, you know, and that's something it takes away by browsing everything. I think, you know, being a teenager, discovering the Burroughs-Gysin cut-up techniques, for instance, like thinking about word virus as like a young writer, really, you know, fully immersed myself in it for months, you know, and it's still one of my sources because it was one of the doors. Mm-hmm. For me, I think if I just looked at that on the internet, yeah, that's nice, that's cute. That, you know, it's not in you the same way as studying it.
Well, there isn't that searching. I mean, you said.
So I found that, and there was nothing else. And then later, you know, then I studied with Roz to perform Jean Genet's The Maids as a death rock Solange and Claire.
Where did you perform that?
It didn't quite happen, but we started memorizing the lines. It's like 5-page monologues in there. I'm not really an actor.
And you were going to do it as a musical performance?
Nope.
Oh, just
straight.
A straight performance art work.
But just as a sideways from there, how, you know, reading Our Lady of the Flowers and going into Genet's political place, like the blacks. Mm-hmm. I would just live in that for a month.
Yeah. But the internet takes a little bit of that away.
I think it does because it's more scattered.
Scanning. We're scanning all the time.
Well, places are disappearing, too, because of apps and things.
Yeah. Well, we talked about the disappearance, the ongoing, and this has been written about in the press, the disappearance of gay bars, that gay bars in Los Angeles are gay clubs, especially dance clubs, are becoming an endangered species. And all those other kinds of little spaces that cater to different subcultures, because the internet has made it so easy to connect that you don't necessarily need those physical spaces that for people to meet at. So it is affecting, in a way, the texture of our city. It's changing the landscape of the city. Which brings me to a sort of related question. Where did you do what you consider your first performance? And what did you do?
That was at Arts Building and Pomona. And I tore through a lot of props. I had roadkill. I trotted out. I did everything abject you could do in 30 minutes.
And how many people were there?
Probably like 30 people from the band TSOL. It was all people from bands. And it wasn't so much what I did, but what I turned into while I was doing it. Like it was a means of channeling for me. So that became my thing, from that moment.
What did you channel?
An altered state. I actually achieved something. I wasn't me being me.
So this was at
I found something surprisingly, like a different articulation in the live work.
And this took place at a mall, a dead mall in Pomona.
Yes.
Oh, that's great. I would rather this be a conversation among everybody. I know it's the end of the day, and I would love it if we could turn this into a nice Q&A session.
So I just had a question about the geography of the undergrounds that you've enacted in, Ron, because it seems almost, the Pomona story is perfect for it. It almost seems like our conventional understanding of underground is something vertical. Los Angeles is so decentralized that it seems like many of the highlight underground places that you've been experienced or been part of are actually peripheral on a horizontal landscape. Is that a way to think about an underground here, like out in the Pomona, out in, you said Eagle Rock, I'll grandfather Eagle Rock as out at a certain point, out in, beyond what we might think of as a core. Is that a reasonable thing to think about in terms of your experience?
I think it was. It also goes into sometimes legal zones, like sex clubs, for instance. There was an understanding that the police didn't patrol anything east of Western. So the bars got more and more unruly the further east you went. So you had the one way on Hoover that was, they were basically sex clubs. And then suddenly, more like in the 90s, the alcoholic beverage control started coming in and kind of shut down places like Cuffs and the last of that. So there were, the west side was for good people. and the further east you got, the gnarlier it got. So then I think why maybe like large clubs like the Vex could go on in East LA. Things always got closed in other parts, in the proper parts of town. So maybe we'll return to suburbia again.
Pomona or bust. Yes,
to help answer this question, a lot of the people who were interested in some of the underground scenes that were living in outlying areas did have to travel quite a distance, and sometimes by public transportation in order to meet others. And so some of the underground, what we would now consider underground newspapers, were mainstream newspapers now, were at one time underground. And we also had underground radio, which had a lot of that, where people would call in and then get together on bulletin boards, early bulletin boards, and chat, early chat rooms like IRC chat. Another topic I want to discuss is, I'll come back to it.
Yes, ma'am?
What is your idea of heaven on earth?
Wow, dude, that's deep.
That's a lot. I'm not sure. I get into the high highs equal low lows on the other side of it. I don't know.
There's a lot in it, because I'm not familiar with your work, and I want to know more about you, but what's coming across to me is funny and poignant.
Thank you.
And resisting. And I'm just wondering, is life for the purpose of resisting, or is resisting for the aim of trying to find heaven on earth? And make it happen.
I'm always suspicious of utopias, so that's why I think I would never frame it that way.
What would make you feel alive today, on this day?
Total engagement, adrenaline.
David? I'm curious about the way that I think, like, geographically, underground scenes sometimes contain their own self-destruction in the sense that, you know, they draw in, let's say, disaffected middle-class youth like myself, and then we come in and the scene becomes sort of begins to become mainstream, a little bit like what you're talking about in terms of the end result of that is Liza Minnelli. And then those communities begin to draw, you know, the artists stake out the territory. The most recent example of this, long since gone, but there was a piece in the Times last month about how, you know, basically we, you know, there are already very few artists in the arts district, and pretty soon it'll just be a label, right? The artists will have been priced out. I've seen this happen again and again in every city I've ever lived in, New York, San Francisco, this city. So I'm curious about, the relationship of kind of the underground community or the underground artist to what eventually, I guess, becomes gentrification of communities, which then prices the artist and the underground community out. Do you have any thoughts on I'm sure you've seen that process take place over and over and over again. So I'm curious about, in some sense, I wonder if the internet, although it's not a physical setting, kind of undercuts that because there is, there's no rent, right? There's no geographical gentrification, although there's certainly corporate gentrification.
I think the internet does have that place, that place where things can develop. But I was thinking of music scenes and back to this book called England's Dreaming. Yeah. And there is a brief part about the West Coast music scene there where it says, if the punk scene lasted like 1 to 2 years in New York and London, it lasted 9 years in California because no one cared about it. So this idea of scrutinizing everything and writing about everything and making everyone in it self-aware while something is developing ends it. It becomes a cartoon of itself before it's realized where it's going to go. I think that's also part of this like short lifespan of scenes now.
And there were flows of communication through radio and bulletin boards and whatever. But were there daytime pubs at the time, or just nighttime clubs and galleries where people could meet up?
There's been a series of coffee houses in LA that were real hubs, like Jabberjaw, the Pick Me Up Cafe.
Atomic Cafe.
So I think these places that didn't just sell things, but they also had events at them or readings, were key.
And important record stores. I mean, having grown up in Orange County, like Licorice Pizza was the place you went to get music news of bands that you weren't going to. Yeah, and there would be zines and posters advertising gigs.
Toxic Shock Records in Pomona.
Yeah, Toxic Shock.
I'm glad you mentioned posters because that's where I was going. What can you say about underground advertising that basically starts with, like people tagging, not exactly tagging, but street art and paste-ups, posters, that sort of thing? Like the Obey. Obey was one that went mainstream and actually made quite a lot of money for one of the people that were involved in the beginning. I personally know somebody who was one of four students who were involved in a project for advertising using alternate means rather than the mainstream advertising. And one of them developed the Sloan character, which is the face. One of them developed the name, which was Obey. The other one, the star, and the other one had basically the border. And they all did their part and they tagged all over LA. So what can you say about these types of promotional activities underground?
I think LA is really specific in that, you know, if people don't walk, somehow it's not as intense as like wheat pasting on St. Mark's in the 80s. I do find like Facebook events pages are amazing, how you can email everyone and post it and tag it different places. It's more efficient. I've promoted clubs over the year, and you know, I remember printing out 1,000 flyers and stapling them all over light poles.
I think I've written about street art quite a bit, and it's this interesting cycle because a lot of street art is actually inspired by political art. Like stencil painting actually came from Italian, was used a lot in Italy in the 1920s as a means to spread political messages really quickly. It was later adopted by artists, sometimes on canvas, later street artists. So it's all part of the strange cycle of street artists come in and take these methods and make them the guerrilla, and then the mainstream comes in and takes these street objects and makes them mainstream, and they're digested back into the culture in a way, like a lot of underground tends to be. I mean, I think LA has some really unique cultural things in that aspect, in the sense that the street art has tended to be very big and visible. Taggers like to go after the advertising billboards. There's this phenomenon of painting, you know, stuff in the LA River that you can read on Google Earth. I think that there are a few cities, like when you think about what the graffiti scene was in New York versus the way it's evolved in LA, it's been very different, I think partially because of the landscape. But yes, it has been methods that started off as political and then became artistic and then were co-opted by street artists, and musical movements have again been kind of cycled back into the culture, sometimes in the case of Obey as merch. And, you know, I'll be curious to see if something else emerges on the street in a kind of organic manner, away as a reaction from that. Do you know what I mean? Yes, sir?
So, one of the things that I'm getting from this is that somehow the avant-garde has died. And I was curious when you think it died.
I don't know if it died. I think it just got more uppity. Yeah. I mean, I was kind of, you know, I was caught up in all this Jesse Helms attacking me, war on culture stuff, and I was on a talk recently at the Walker Art Center about that, and I started thinking, is this even relevant anymore? Does anybody get national funding? And there's, you know, the ball was picked up by private billionaires, you know, creative capital scheme sort of got bigger and bigger, so that, you know, there's places that artists work now, like the Broad Museum, where you have no restrictions on you. You're not going to be taken to task for a morality clause about people's taxpayer money. It, like, kind of eliminated stuff like that. So one less thing to rub against, but a different kind of institution to work in. Thank you.
So what are we rubbing against now? I mean, there's a lot to rub against right now, isn't there? This is, you know, it's got this
there
between
is
the president and certain Alabama senatorial candidate. And
I'm feeling kind of 80s women. Again. Like during the Reagan era, there was a coherentness around everybody in the scene of even loving your own culture more, because everything else felt like the enemy. Yep.
So do you have a sense for what happens when the underground, or maybe perhaps this specific movement, gets appropriated or gentrified? What does it do for the community? You kind of just touched on it now, that at some point, even though you may not have like this physical space of underground culture, you're still able to come back as a community and love each other. What does it do for those people that lose out because of gentrification or appropriation of that culture?
I was just thinking that some of the writing of Sarah Shulman and gentrification of the mind, I think it does become a spiritual, psychic, personal issue when something's been taken away from you, space or your thing has been made obsolete by Lady Gaga, for instance. It's, I don't want to go down a sour grapes road, but it's harsh.
Anyone else?
Yes.
I wanted to ask you a bit about, first of all, is this the first time you're teaching this class on the underground at USC?
Specifically that one, yes.
And how are you kind of conveying a sense of this experience to the students?
I'm trying not to close it up in conclusions, because I never went to school, but I've been teaching for, you know, since I started making art, either workshops or visiting places. That there's something besides referring to the medium itself, and there's something outside of the academy where juicy, soulful things come from. Whether, you know, I don't know, I have a research-based practice, so I'm just trying to share that not only are some of these scenes that I've been through, but some of them are just things that I've studied. For instance, being raised Pentecostal, you know, I'm a Amy Semple McPherson scholar. The Illustrated Sermon. I did go to Miss Velma's Universal World Church. So there's aspects of church that I still study almost daily, because it's an obsession that I wasn't necessarily a part of.
Yes.
So in part, and this goes back to thinking about the Broad and Lady Gaga and morality clauses, if in part a morality clause was a thing to reject, maybe one of the elements of the neoliberal capitalism we inhabit now is that it's something like acts of consumption or the market that are the unchallengeables, and that there's a permissiveness perhaps around morality so long as it's something consumable. So I'm wondering if that becomes a much more amorphous target to aim at, and that's the source of some of the discontent here? And if that's the case, you know, how do you kill an amoeba, I guess?
I don't know if I quite thought of it that way, but that I always need something to rub against. I feel like when everything's used up, then it goes back to esoterica or philosophy.
Response to change and cultural or artistic response to change. And in the context of changing environments, changing world, species, they do one of three things. They move, or they can adapt, or they can go extinct. And I wonder if you see sort of parallels of that in your world.
I see those things, and then I also feel like I'm getting older. I'm not sure. I look at the distance from that. Or, you know, if you read something dystopian like Octavia Butler, and it's like makes you cringe, that is this what happens when, or Don DeLillo, when you hit this certain population that everything's going to blank out and turn into Logan's Run? Yeah. That's more what I'm worried about, that there is no answer except Scientology at this point. What about the wink after that?
I just wanted to, like, not sound like a question, more of a comment, just to tie into the philosophical, like, quandary. Like, it seems like there's, like, a lineage of, like, philosophical underpinnings to a lot of these movements. The situation is in the 1968, and that sort of, like, permeates throughout the 80s. I'm doing a research thing on architecture in Los Angeles and how it affects our, like, psyche. I'm surveying a lot of Paul Virilio. And just sort of way of thinking about the surface of the city and how we're just essentially, the surface of the city resembles our phones. And so it's like this parallel of like being reflected to ourselves constantly and how to attack that reflection and how to like step away from contemporary architecture as a way to like attack how it's affecting our psyche. So I think we need to really challenge how we navigate the city, because the city is becoming something that doesn't reflect us anymore, even though it's using mechanisms that seem like it reflects us, but it doesn't. So, anyway, I'm grappling with that right now as a way to navigate the city in a way that's truly visceral again. And that's the question that I have right now for myself. So, it's not a question, it's more.
Yeah, no, that's.
But that made me think of a real issue, is that in the early 80s when I was, you know, we would go everywhere. I saw the Slits at the Vex. The next night I went to hear a reading at Beyond Baroque in Venice Beach. These things were doable in 20 minutes then. And now we have a more neighborhood-bound city, unless you just don't care that you spend 5 hours a day driving, which I don't have the patience for it. So I find myself, you know, I go to downtown, and I hardly ever go to Culver City. If I have to go to the Hammer Museum at the wrong time, I never want to go again.
That sounds really amazing. I'm really interested in, speaking of those attacks on architecture, it's like vernacular architecture, because it is really fascinating to me how people construct their own environments rather than live in environments that are pre-constructed, or they might take an environment that's pre-constructed and then adapt it in really interesting and bizarre ways, and I find that along the lines. And so I'm constantly, as a reporter, I'm constantly all around Los Angeles, and I'm constantly looking for those spaces that look like they've been kind of DIY'd, or, oh, it's a building with something hammered on, or like the house I live in, whoever lived in it before added this extension on the back that is literally just attached to the outside of the house, so we call it the barnacle. It's like a barnacle on our house. It's connected in no other way. It's just this weird structure kind of attached to that. And so I'm constantly looking for things like that, because it really strikes me as this idea of like hacking the surface, of like people just kind of prying apart what's been given to them and manipulating it in ways that makes it hospitable.
Yeah, there's this tendency to go vertical, but then what if we start thinking, if we go oblique, you know, which is like something that Virilio argues for, it's like going for like a ramp type of like consciousness, or like what I would like to think of as spatial consciousness. Uh-huh. So it's like the divide between trying to affirm a spatial consciousness that's actually real, as opposed to the virtual space that we're being like propelled to.
Yeah.
There's this thing about Rem Koolhaas, he did the show at the Venice Biennale, and he was like commenting on architecture. And he was saying, for the most part, the way that things are constructed in buildings is like, you know, you have your drywall here, and then you have all the space behind the drywall in order to segment.
Yeah, all these regulations.
Yeah, exactly. Or, for example, in the gentrification forum, there's these like houses that like Hispanic families have lived in, and they've like attached all these like weird things, and then there's like people that come in to renovate it, you know, and they say things like, bring the house back to its natural splendor, as if like, you know, they come in saying that, you know.
Yeah.
So also going back to what you're saying about the barnacle, it's like the consciousness of the house and how it permeates, and, you know, and
yeah.
comes in and says, well, that was all wrong. You know, this is
our environments are highly regulated. It's really interesting that you bring up that Rem Koolhaas thing. And I think people are always trying to find ways to kind of bust through that. And in public space too, there's a really interesting, do you know the sculptor John Peterson? He did a lot of stuff in LA in the 80s. He used to make these things called, in the 80s, apparently in downtown, they used to refer to the homeless a lot as bums or hobos. That was the vernacular. And so he used to make these sculptures that would fit into these weird little corners of the city that people could then inhabit. It almost created a shelter, but they were these shiny kind of like light and space type things. Like they totally didn't belong on the street, but he would make these weird little shelters out of them. And you know, sometimes when a fence comes into a point and there's space and it can't really be used for anything, he would make like a shelter out of it, and they were called, it was a series called Bum Shelters, and so it was taking that idea of like taking this highly regulated city environment and saying, nope, I'm going to transform this little unused corner into something for which it wasn't intended, but for which it is being used anyway, because the homeless are hacking the city in interesting ways as well.
Not if you just are willing to break rules and navigate the city according, or navigate your reality according to your rules, you know, anyway.
What's your avant-garde?
Well, I was just thinking the one thing that is invisible to all of us sometimes is how much homeless lean-to shelters are on all Caltrans property now that everyone's been pushed out of downtown, and probably those populations have increased. I mean, that's a part of LA that I find devastating.
Yeah, for sure. Yes?
Just tying back to the metaphor, paleontological metaphor, basically the AIDS plague has acted like a mass extinction of much of the people who frequented the scene that you described. How would you describe the survivors? Are they looking back? Are they trying to adapt to the now, because they lost basically 10, 15 years of their lives in fear.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's different examples. There's a lot of people where ACT UP activism and the way the community was passionately engaged with each other and even understanding differences in each other. There's no reason to reach each other on this side of that, at that intensity. Like, I always think communities happen when they're needed. They're hard to design. They pull together like that, or the ones that really feel. I think it's an emptiness on the other side of it, you know, because it didn't end in a way like, oh, AIDS is cured, now everyone's okay. You know, we have weird scarring and absences. I don't know what to do. You can't feel all of those people gone all the time.
Yes, could you compare and contrast the music and the performance art scenes? I mean, you were part of both of them, you sort of merged them. But there were a lot of other people who were just more performers or more bands, if you will. And I know they sort of mashed together in the 80s. But did they have different undergrounds, different sort of principles to their undergrounds?
I feel like there was a music scene type of performance. Like, I can think of a lot of events that happened in Rough Space in downtown LA in the early 80s. I think they fused together because that was an era where performance was exiled from the gallery and from the art center. So that was one of the places, you know, besides special events where it could be. I was actually surprised when I started seeing work that was returned to the 70s, like durational, really minimal action work where someone just looks like themselves in a room for 2 days. Like, oh.
Yeah, and I think there was a lot of artists who were in bands and playing downtown in bands, but also making art and sometimes turning their music into performance. Like, I think of Marnie Weber, who played in a band and made art, but then has also used the band as part.
Or Skip Arnold was a big part of the art and music scene in downtown as well. Yeah, and. Well, venues like Lace too, they would have music scenes there. Like, Lace was a different beast in the downtown years, for sure.
And I think it was going back to those linkages, these undergrounds being connected in so many ways, that like someone like Gerardo connected the Chicano art scene of East LA to the synth punk scene to queer performance. See, like, there were just these little links, and the art scene in general, I think, was smaller. So even if everybody had their own flavor, there were these overlaps.
Oh, and that rare, that small period where there was, where LA and San Francisco were allies. You know, that did like this live at Target. Like, they loved Johanna Wendt, they loved Nervous Gender, they loved the Screamers, and we loved the Avengers and Survival Research Laboratories and the Dead Kennedys. Like, it was one scene in a way, you know, and which separated later.
Last one, I think.
Okay, last one. We can chat after.
Is there any connection with this scene you're describing with anarchists?
I definitely wasn't that sophisticated at the time. I did listen to Crass. But I didn't have that sophisticated of politics. I think I was vaguely anarchistic.
Yes, so, to answer this, some of these, I've been a member of certain subcultures and certain underground scenes, but what you would like to do is, in order to remain cool, is to enter the new, you know, what's coming up next. Well, you know, I've grown up. I'm not gonna be there anymore. But what I want to say is that some of these subcultures overlap, and as you mentioned earlier, the different punk scenes that were going on in different areas are actually all part of one scene, but there are sub-scenes within these, and then there are certain subcultures like the skinheads or the neo-Nazis. The neo-Nazis don't have to be punk rockers, but there are a lot of punk rockers who were neo-Nazis. So yeah, some of these would, yeah, they would have overlapped and they would have been some of the anarchists.
In LA?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Huntington Beach is a big source of neo-Nazis and punk. So there's a big crossover there. Yay, Huntington. Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming.
Thanks so much to Ron and Carolina for that last and very, very stimulating panel. And I'm going to ask my friend and colleague, Karen Huebner, to step up and give us the benediction.
Thanks. Thanks so much for that wonderful discussion we just had. So I first want to thank Bill and David for conceptualizing this project and conference and inviting the Harmon Academy to participate and to partner. I would also like to thank the USC Libraries for housing the event and being supportive in every sort of way to make this happen. But I also want to especially thank the panelists and contributors that I see that are still here for just bringing their passion. I think that was what we ended on a lot. I felt it. Expertise as well and wisdom about the subterranean worlds of Los Angeles that they are purveyors of. And so I really thank you. It was really a great day. I think we would all agree. And about that which lies beneath us, Lewis Mumford, who was mentioned earlier today, wrote, "The underground city threatens to become the ultimate crypt of our incinerated civilization." I know. It's a terrifying image that Mumford paints. And yet he captures in many ways many of what we imagine, the underground, the mysterious, the frightening, the foreign. I mean, Bill, you mentioned that the underground is fascinating to you in your opening and also, you know, frightening. And I think we all feel that, and that's what, you know, gives some of the edginess to the cultural underworld as well. And sometimes it's even seen as a place of anti-life. But I think things have changed today after this whole day of panels. And the worlds and systems under our feet hold value and meanings that today's conference brought to the surface for us. Curiously, Mumford seemed not to think too highly of the world underground or was very inquisitive about it. While I hold a deep reverence for Mumford, in some ways I think he might have felt differently. He would have expanded his horizons, so to speak, about the deep, had he been able to join us today. But we humans are inextricably connected to that which is below, perhaps in deeper ways than we cared to think about before today. We employ powerful imagery when referencing the world and worlds below us. We call it a womb, some do. We also call it hell, some do. We bury seeds in the earth to germinate to life, to feed us. We also bury our dead, our beloved, there too. We engineer space below to transport us freely to and fro, freedom. But we've also constructed space in the same earth to shelter us from annihilation. My relationship to the ground under my feet has changed after today, I think. I always imagined underground as deadly silence. But now I know it is quite noisy down there. It also holds most of what we call the past, rather humbling to an above-ground historian like myself. And I'm not a little troubled that the symbiotic, parasitic relationship between ants and beetles might say more about my humanness and my relationship to humans, other humans, than I really want to hear. Am I the beetle or am I the ant? That's what I want to know. So I will be pondering this for quite a while. But it's the image of the zombie diatoms bubbling up to the surface of the tar pits that might most disturb me. And being an Angeleno also gave me a pretty good idea for a screenplay, but we'll talk about that. Our seismologist from the first panel and missile magazine expert from the afternoon session left me a little discomforted. The fractured windshield image of the myriad of fault lines and Margarita drinking Ajax missile series, missile centuries leaves me a bit shaken, I think. So maybe Mike Davis might have been right. LA is the most dangerous place to live on the planet. But Henry David Thoreau wrote, "We are acquainted with a mere pellicle of the globe on which we live. Most have not delved 6 feet beneath the surface, nor leaped as many above it. We know not where we are." Today, I think we know a little bit more about where we are. And I think Thoreau would have been pleased with the excavations we engaged in today in the subterranean worlds of LA, the natural, cultural, and social, and engineered. Marcus Aurelius urged, "Look beneath the surface, and let not the several quality of a thing nor its worth escape thee." Today we looked deep beneath the surface of this several quality of a thing called Los Angeles, its natural, engineered, and cultural underworlds. And as a consequence, I think its worth has been brightened. With the guidance of our expert panelists and guest discussants, the audience queries and insights throughout the day, we have broadened and deepened and illuminated our understanding and vision of the City of Angels. As we leave this space, I was just thinking about this, as I leave this space and walk outside, onto the sidewalk or the grass, I believe we may step a little more carefully and intentionally and more cognizant of the systems and life teeming under us, imagining now the worlds that lie below our feet and outside of our view with more color, more meaning, and still more mysterious. And just one last pitch for my film. I have a title. Zombie Diatoms versus the Beetle Ant. A Trump apocalypse. And this is LA anyway. So anybody want to talk to me about it afterwards, just let me know. So thank you all for coming, and safe travels under and above ground. Thank you.